You know, I was... Hi, I'm Julie Reeves. You're watching Green at Beacon.com, a member of the Beacon Media Group.
The force, it's got a lot of power, and it makes me feel like... You know, I was wondering, you know, if you could keep on, because the force, it's got a lot of power, and it makes me feel like... It makes me feel like...
Hello out there. I hope everyone is staying warm and having a wonderful Wednesday. This is Midweek Sports Shop Talk, and we hope to make your day even better. I'm Aaron Snyder, sports editor of The Independent. I'm here with Hank Bond of the Green at Beacon. We're here to try to spice up your lunch break with this sports variety show. We're live at greenatbeacon.com, as we will be most Wednesdays at 1 p.m. You can also watch the broadcast later at dailyindependent.com or greenatbeacon.com. We're at Chick-fil-A at Ashland, where Steve and Dee Dee Barfield have graciously allowed us to invade their space, maybe scare off a few customers every week. So thank you to the Barfields, and thank you to First and People's Bank, our sponsor. Also, a thank you goes out to East Carter girls basketball coach Hager Easterling. He's our special guest today. We'll be right back to talk local high school, college, and pro sports in just a moment.
First and People's Bank has six convenient locations to serve you. From South Shore to the main office, First and People's Bank has been serving this area with complete banking services since 1932. Visit the home office near you, First and People's Bank, member FDIC, equal housing lender.
We are the home office. Come visit any of our six locations.
First and People's Bank.
Welcome back. So what's everybody buzzing about? If you didn't already know Richard Sherman, you do now. So no one should be surprised. But if you knew him before, no one should be surprised. It is not even sideline reporter Aaron Andrews. The embattled Seahawks quarterback has had a history of sounding off like a maniac. He just never had this big of a stage as his platform before. If you didn't see it or literally have lived under a rock since Sunday, Sherman blew up on national TV following the Seahawks win over 49ers in the NFC Championship game. He called Michael Crabtree a sorry receiver and a mediocre receiver, claimed he was the best cornerback in the league. It was so intense you could sense the nervousness from Aaron Andrews in the interview. All she managed were two questions before Sherman got away. I probably would have felt the same way if I was Andrews, but then again, it was nothing unexpected if you know who Sherman is. People are calling Sherman classless, which is somewhat true. They're also calling him an idiot, which is somewhat true. Crabtree is not a mediocre receiver, so that was kind of a stupid thing to say. Now, a lot of people are jumping on the Broncos bandwagon because of this incident. Well, that's probably where it needs to stop, because if you need a reason to root for a team, look at the bigger picture. If you want to pull for the Broncos, that's fine. But don't do it just because you're disgusted with one of the Seahawks players. He definitely isn't and shouldn't be the face of the Seahawks franchise, but TV made him that. Fox even went back to him two separate times after that pro wrestling style interview. They went back to him again twice. But Russell Wilson, for instance, their quarterback, he's a very well respected guy on and off the field. And then on the other side of the coin is Peyton Manning, the quarterback for the Broncos. I'm sticking with the Broncos in the game because I picked them before the season started. I did that in print. The embarrassing part, I had them beating the Giants. I really dropped the ball on that one. Okay, so I know there are a few Browns fans out there. I feel for you. I really do. Because the Bengals went through the era of ineptitude as well through the 90s. So I've been there. Cleveland hasn't found a coach just yet. Because some of the most highly regarded names have reportedly said they don't want the job. Well, it at least appears that way. Adam Gase is the offensive coordinator of the Broncos. He's a highly talented guy. He might be the right guy to be patient for. He's not interviewing yet, and he said he's not going to interview, but that could change after the Super Bowl. He could have a change of heart. He's focused on the Super Bowl right now, so if I'm the Browns, I'm being patient. I want to get that right guy that's going to be there for a while. Baseball fans, the Cincinnati Reds caravan's coming to Ashland on Saturday. They'll be at Fannin Motors from 4 p.m. to 7 p.m. Homer Bailey's going to be there. He has two no-hitters under his belt, so he might be a guy you want to come out and meet. And new manager Brian Price will be there. Unsigned Homer Bailey, that's right. Going through some different contract things, some arbitration things with Homer Bailey right now, so that'll be interesting. And new manager Brian Price will be there. Kentucky is coming off a 68-51 victory over Texas A&M on Tuesday night. My question is, what the heck is going on with Willie Cauley-Stein? In 1.4 fouls. It's three straight games now he has not offensively performed. So after sitting out most of the second half, he came into the game at the end and turned it over on two straight possessions. So I'm not sure what's going on with him. I think the Wildcats need to start Dakari Johnson at center. He's more physical. He brings more passion. He doesn't have as many mental lapses as Cauley-Stein does right now. Cauley-Stein still needs quality playing time, but Johnson is the number one option to me right now. Some of the upcoming college games, Kentucky, they're 14-4. They host Georgia at Rupp Arena on Saturday. Morehead State's 13-7 now. They go to Belmont on Thursday. Marshall's 6-13. They play at Rice on Thursday. And UK women, they're 15-3. They host Alabama on Thursday. Those are the upcoming college games. Now, shifting gears over to high school. The earth-shattering story, at least in this area this past week, surrounded Russell football. Ivan McGlone was relieved of his duties as head coach after 38 years. The seventh all-time winningest coach in Kentucky didn't leave on his own terms, so that has left a lot of people unhappy about the way it ended. I'm not going to speculate as to who will take over as the next head coach. I don't know. Rumors are flying, but we don't know. But I will say that I don't exactly envy that person, especially at the moment, just because, first of all, McGlone's a tough act to follow. And it's a strange situation to follow. However, it's still one of the premier coaching jobs in the area, I believe, and contending for a Class 3A state title is not exactly a far-fetched idea there. Also in football, Fairview football has a new head coach. Fred Ray takes over. He was an assistant there from 2009 to 2012, and he was a starting quarterback at Ohio University in the early 2000s. The 33-year-old already seems to have a strong rapport with the players and people in the school, so all indications point to it being a pretty fine hire. Cancellations are stacking in high school basketball. Several games were called off last night. Some are being canceled tonight. Rowan County Fairview Boys has been called off already. The All-A semifinal games, there's some shakeup there in Olive Hill. Raceland and West Carter Boys will play tonight at 6 instead of 7:30. And West Carter Menifee County Girls has been moved to Thursday, and I believe that's at 6 p.m. as well. And then I haven't got confirmation on this yet, but the All-A championship games will be Friday now in Olive Hill. Some more upcoming games to circle on the calendar in high school basketball. Thursday's kind of a packed night if they play, which hopefully they do. McGoffin County, Boyd County Girls, Ashland, Greenup County Girls. Lawrence County, Russell Boys is an interesting game just because it gives area fans a chance to see Lawrence County. They're a very talented young team. Russell, East Carter Girls on Friday. How about those Lady Raiders? They're ranked 6th in the state now. Coach Hager Easterling is standing by to join me in just a little bit. Also on Friday, Ashland at Boyd County Boys. The Tomcats won the first meeting. Spring Valley at Ashland Boys on Saturday. Lewis Rowan girls also on Saturday, and Lewis Raceland girls on Monday. Lewis County, I mentioned them a couple times just because they're coming off an impressive overtime win over Russell this past week. And then next Tuesday, a few games to circle: Ashland, East Carter, Rowan County, Greenup County, Boyd County, Russell. And finally, I want to mention the semi-pro basketball team, the Kentucky Kings. They open their season on this Saturday at the National Guard Armory against the Louisville Flash at 6 p.m. There's some good tri-state representation on the team, and there's some decent area representation, too, a few from area high schools. We'll be right back with East Carter girls basketball coach Hager Easterling in just a minute.
Bank has six convenient locations to serve you. From South Shore to the main office, First and People's Bank has been serving this area with complete banking services since 1932. Visit the home office near you, First and People's Bank, member FDIC, equal housing lender.
We are the home office. Come visit any of our six locations.
Welcome back to Midweek Sports Shop Talk. We're here with East Carter girls basketball coach Hager Easterling. Good to have you, Hager.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.
That was a good use of words there. My pleasure. We're at Chick-fil-A. That's what they like to say. So,
I love Chick-fil-A.
Another snow day for area schools. How do you usually spend your snow day? Do you like to go out and roll around in a little bit, or you spend your time indoors guzzling hot chocolate?
The indoors part now. I'm a little old for the rolling around in the snow. My daughter and her friend were out in the snow yesterday, but I'm more of the indoors now. I'm past that age.
How much do these kind of days affect high school basketball teams? How much does it affect your rhythm, routine, things like that when you're coaching and dealing with your players on these snow days?
Well, I think a lot of it is just, how do you let it affect you? How do you approach it mentally? And it's just something that you can't control, so you deal with it. It's like on the way over here, I was talking to a good friend of mine, Jeff Brown, that coaches Morgan County's girls. And they were, as you mentioned, they were supposed to play the All-A tonight, Wes and Menifee, and he's preparing to play the winner in the championship. Well, now that's canceled. He wasn't sure when they were going to play. I think Morgan County has a policy of not letting him practice a lot of times when they're under a weather advisory, and he was just really upset about it. But it's just something that you have to deal with, and just like anything else, you try to teach your kids you control the things you can control, and weather's not one of them. So whatever comes, we'll deal with it, and we'll be ready to go when the game starts.
Well, Coach, your team is off to an excellent start, 18-1, the best start in program history. What would you point to as the best quality of this team?
Oh, I think without a doubt, besides being good players, it's their unselfishness. And I think that's shown up all year long. I believe we've had six or seven different people lead us in scoring in different games, you know, different times. And we, all five starters, are averaging somewhere between 7 and 8 and 11 and 12 points a game. And they really, they pick each other up a lot. Just for example, this past week, we go down to Fleming County and play, and, you know, Haley Hall's a little bit off offensively, and Greenhill picks her up. She's got 19 points. We go to Boyd County Saturday night, and Greenhill really does a nice job defensively, but she only takes 3 shots and doesn't score. Well, Haley has 16 points. She's ready to go that night. And they've done that all year, and they pick each other up, and they're really grounded. They really don't care a whole lot about publicity and the stories and things like that. They're just interested in winning. You know, there was an old show used to be on the Top 40, Casey Kasem. And at the end of it, I'll show my age here. You probably never heard of him. I know you have.
I've heard of him.
But at the end of every show, he would always say, keep your feet on the ground, keep reaching for the stars. And I think that's what these kids do.
Do they, I mean, you said they don't really pay attention to too much, but, you know, the fact that you guys are now ranked sixth in the state, I voted you fifth, by the way.
Thank you.
Well, you're welcome. I had to throw that in there. But how much do they pay attention to that, or how much do you pay attention to that?
Well, it's a nice recognition for the kids. I found out down through the years that that doesn't really win you a whole lot of games when the game starts, because if anything, it makes the other team that you're playing come at you even harder, which that's the way you want it. You want to see the best that they've got. But there might have been a couple of them that knew that, Aaron. We had to tell them. You know, I think this is the kind of group, the reason we told them about that, the rankings and different papers and stuff, I think this group can handle that. You know, a lot of times you worry about kids when something like that happens. You know, oh, they'll get the big head, they'll stop working, they'll stop focusing, stop working to get better. But this group is not really like that. They've kind of embraced the spotlight and the big games all year long. And as I said, they're very grounded, and they just take it and say, oh, that's nice, let's go get ready for practice.
Your only loss was to a team who's ranked number one in the state right now in Elizabethtown. How good are they?
They're really good. I can probably sum up their team in one definition here for you. They've got a sophomore that's already been offered by UConn. So that tells you how good they are. They're big and they're quick and they're good shooters. The game that we played them, you know, as I just said, we've really done a good job answering the bell and playing under the limelight and spotlight games. And it wasn't that we were afraid of them. We were just too anxious. I think we were too anxious to show everybody how good we are. And we rushed things and never did get into a rhythm offensively. Now, they beat us 17 points. We're talking about the number one team in the state. They beat us 17 points, but we only shot 18%. So you would think in the number one team in the state, you only shoot 18%, you're going to get beat 30 or 40 points. But we guarded well. We rebounded well. You know, we got out there and competed with them. And that's why I told the girl, you know, if we just shot pitiful instead of pathetic, we'd have been in the game. But, you know, I love our team. And E-Town's really good. They're very deserving of their number one ranking.
You mentioned that your team has been guarded well in that game, and they've been guarding pretty well overall. In the region, you guys are 11-0, and no team has scored 50 points on you guys all season in the region. So who are some of your defensive leaders? What are some of the reasons for that?
Well, I think you start with Greenhill. She's the only senior we have on the team, and the good thing about her is you can put her on probably – well, inside the region, maybe one through four spots, and she could guard any of them. You know, she guards the ball. She can guard people away from the ball. She's very sound fundamentally, and she's very intelligent defensively, and just reads things away from the ball really well. But, you know, I mentioned her, and then I can't do that without saying something about all of them, because they do such a good job, again, being a team on the defensive end. Megan Stickler has just studied the angles and spacing and so forth. She's turned herself into a really good defensive player. And then, of course, Krista Mayo, everybody knows about her. She's just a ball of energy out there. Kelsey Stumbo, I mentioned after the game the other night.
Four blocks against Boyd Kelly.
Yeah, and you know, the thing about that is, like Bill Russell used to say, you know, I only block, you know, maybe four, five, six shots a game. But the key was the other team didn't know which four or five or six I was going to block. And it really became an intimidation factor. And I think Kelsey does that a lot to the other teams, especially early in the game, because she likes to volleyball them sometimes. You know, when you go inside and you have one spiked over in the bleachers, it is kind of intimidating. And then Haley Hall, just she's so athletic and quick and keeps getting better and better. And then you come off the bench with people like Alexis Pennington and Abby Dameron on the perimeter, and they'll get out there and get after you. And then Ashley Bays and Kaylee Lemmings. Kaylee comes in a lot for Kelsey. And they just knock and bang. And, we are a team defensively as well as offensively, and that's what I like about us.
A deep team, a balanced team overall, and both sides of the ball. That you guys, your last region, East Carter girls' last region title came in 2004. Do you find yourself comparing teams to that one sometimes?
Well, I don't really do it. I think a lot of people in Grayson are doing that right now, but, you know, I don't really do it. Every team is different, Aaron. Even from one year to the next, if you don't have anybody graduate, that team is going to be different because kids are growing older and they're maturing and they're changing, you know, emotionally and physically. And that's really a lot of what happened with this team right now. You know, we lost three seniors last year. But the kids that came back, they've changed so much in their makeup. They're physically stronger. They're emotionally more mature. They're so much more confident in themselves and in each other. So, you know, that team was really good. And I guess you would have to say, as far as East Carter goes, that's probably been the best team in the school's history because they're the only ones won a region. I mean, eventually, that's what you're measured against. Right. So, you know, we'll see where this team measures up at the end of the year.
Your daughter, Kristen, is now on the coaching staff, correct?
Yes, that's correct.
So what's it like having her on the sidelines?
Well, it's been great. I tell you, Aaron, I'm one of those people that I've always subscribed to the old adage that when a door closes, God opens a window somewhere else and it's better. I've always felt like that. And Coach Steele, that has been with me for 14 years, a job opportunity came up and he had to work more hours and he had to quit. And, you know, it just killed us, him and us both. Him having to quit, but when he quit, then my daughter Kristen and Courtney Sparks, her best friend, who is like my daughter, I take her off my taxes last two or three years. She's at my house so much. But they both came to me and wanted to do it, and I tell you, it's been just what these kids needed, really. They've been great with them. They've got somebody that's closer to their age that they can relate to, you know, and they're on the female side, and they've been great with them all summer, and they just energy on the bench. They're constantly on them about that, and the kids talk to them a lot, and they get really they get into the game. And in practice now, we've progressed to the point where Coach Dameron and Coach Doyle and I pretty much work with the varsity on one end of the floor when we split up, and Coach Court and Coach Chris, as they like to be called, they take our freshmen, our middle schoolers on the other end. And they were two very competitive people as players, and they're very competitive as coaches. And it's just a joy having them both around, really.
And her senior year, you guys were region runners-up, correct?
Yes, that's correct.
So that was a pretty good team, too.
Yeah, that was a pretty good team. We just ran into one that was a little bit better in Round County that year.
Yeah. Now, how long have you been the head coach at East Carter? Because you've been in coaching overall for how many years, 34?
What about head coach?
16 with Coach Baker with the boys, and this is my 18th year with the girls.
What's the secret to coaching at one place for so long?
I don't really know because I'm sure that if you go to Grayson, you're going to find a lot of people that would say, I wish he hadn't been here so long. I know you're going to find a lot of people that would say that, so I don't really know. I think it's just been consistent in what you do, and you treat people right, and you try to run a good program, and I think we've done that. And then I've always had good support from the administration. I think that's always been important, whether it's been our principal or superintendent or athletic director or whoever. But I think the biggest thing is you just try to be fair with everybody. You don't treat everybody the same because everybody's not the same. You know, if you did that, you'd have Kelsey Stumble playing point guard and Krista Mayo playing center sometimes.
Right.
But you treat everybody fair, and you're consistent in what you do, and you just you try to be a good example to the kids about representing East Carter the way that you want them to, and in a classy way. And I think that we've always done that and tried to teach the kids that, and that's probably the secret to longevity.
Well, 38 years is kind of the benchmark around here with Coach McGlone at Russell. Do you see yourself coaching the girls 20 more years to reach that mark?
Well, I think we'll just let God decide that, because 18 years ago when I went from the boys to the girls, I had a whole bunch of people ask me why. As a matter of fact, your boss right now, Mark Maynard, called that day, and that was the first question he asked is, why? Why would you do that, hey? And I felt back then that that's where God wanted me to be for whatever reason, and the reasons came pretty clear the older that I got, and I still think that's where he wants me to be. And everybody asked me that, which I guess that's a sign that you're getting old, when at the end of every year everybody asks if you're coming back next year. So I'm getting that question a lot. But, you know, I'll let God decide that. If he tells me he wants me to quit at the end of this year, I'll quit. And if he wants me to coach, you know, 15, 20 more years, we'll leave that up to him.
You coming back next year? No, I'm just kidding. So what are your thoughts on the boys' side of things this year in the area? How much have you been able to follow boys' basketball?
Well, from what I followed, it seems like Fleming County's pretty much established herself as the best team in the region, and that's without Burns. Now, when he comes back, I think a lot of people are maybe hoping that will disrupt their chemistry where he's been out so long, which if they were undefeated, you know, or something like that, and he comes back, I think that might be a problem. You know, players might look, well, we were winning without him. But they've had some losses, and they've got beat pretty good a couple of times. So I think they'll be glad to welcome him back. I know Round County's really good. They've played Fleming tough a couple of times. I know Ashland's having a good year. They're going to be in there. A couple of surprise teams. I think Elliott County is surprising some people.
They have 13 wins, I believe.
Yeah, and, you know, they just play the game so smart. They play intelligent, and they understand angles, and they don't hurt themselves, and the nights that they shoot really well, they could probably beat anybody in the region. So, you know, I think it'll be an interesting year for the boys.
So I know you're a big Kentucky fan too. Do the Wildcats, do you think they have what it takes to make a run in March this year?
Well, if Cal can ever get the AAU basketball out of him, I think that's what he's going through right now. You know, it just seems like anymore that kids are just so interested in their sales than more so than the team a lot of times. And I think a great example of that, Aaron, was when Kentucky played Michigan State. I mean, you probably watched that game, at least some of it. Think back to how many times that after a made shot or made free throw, Michigan State beat, I say us because I'm a huge Kentucky fan, Michigan State beat us down the floor and got to the rim either for a basket or a foul. Well, you know the reason that happened is because in AAU ball, when you score, the other team just takes it out and walks it down the floor. They're not used to that. And that's what I mean. He's got to get that AAU ball out of them. He's got to get that bad body language out of them, the negative reaction to calls, things, again, that you can't control like we were speaking of a few minutes ago. I think one thing that he does have going this year is that he's got a bench that he didn't have last year. And that bench, you know, is a good thing to have. Now, yeah, of course he had a bench last year, but he didn't have anybody that the kids on the floor knew were coming in for him and going to start. You know, Hawkins is starting to play a little bit better. Polson has given him some good minutes here and there. And then Johnson, the car like you mentioned a few minutes ago, he is really coming on. And he did start the second half the other night. He deserved it. He did it because he deserved it. If they can get that AAU mentality out of them, start playing harder defensively, something they've got to do. They just don't play hard every possession defensively. If they'll learn to do that and just play tougher, get out of that pouting and stuff, yeah, I think they got a chance to make a run.
You mentioned Alex Poitras. He was a guy last night that came in, and he had a great game off the bench and a great play where he charged through the lane and just slammed it down one-handed. And if you were in his way, you were getting out of his way. That would be the smart thing to do anyway. So, but Poitras had 16 points, and he's a guy, like you said, you know, they had a bench 2 years ago when Darius Miller came off the bench. And so if Poitras can come off and give them a lift, consistently, I think that's key, isn't it?
Yeah, it is, and I think a lot of the things that people overlook a couple years ago when they did win the national title is you had three freshmen starting, but you had two of them, Anthony Davis and Kid Gilchrist, that wanted to win more than anything else, and you could tell that from even watching them in the McDonald's All-Star game. I mean, those kids were playing that game to win. They weren't playing it to showcase their skills. They were playing to win, and they played the same way when they got to Kentucky. The question mark that year was Teague, and he started off, if y'all remember, pretty rough. He started out like an AAU player, and he was in the doghouse a lot.
That's right.
But I think, like you mentioned, they had Miller, who was a senior, obviously, and then they had two other people in Lamb and Jones who had already been through a year with Calipari. And they kind of drug him along with Davis and Gilchrist. Hey, you know, win is the most important thing. Let's get your act in gear. And we want to play this to win. They didn't have anybody do that last year. Nobody to do that. So, you know, I think with some of the kids they've got this year, and like you mentioned, Poitras, the play that he had, the dunk, you see that a lot on NBA highlights where when somebody's flying to the rim, instead of trying to block the shot or take a charge, those NBA guys are ducking out of the way. Well, that's what they were doing last night. Oh, man, he was a freight train coming through there. He was. But if he keeps playing like that and they can get WCS, as everybody likes to call him, or Goldie Blocks, whatever you want to call him, going again, they're probably going to have him to make a run. Yeah, I think they got a shot.
Well, Coach, being here at Chick-fil-A, it's fitting to say it was our pleasure to have you on the show today, and we appreciate you coming down.
Absolutely, anytime. You know me. I talk basketball anywhere, anytime, any place. I'm ready. Thank you.
Well, good luck the rest of the season.
All right, buddy. Thank you.
We'll be right back.
Christian People's Bank has 6 convenient locations to serve you. From South Shore to the main office, First and People's Bank has been serving this area with complete banking services since 1932. Visit the home office near you, First and People's Bank, member FDIC, equal housing lender.
We are the home office. Come visit any of our 6 locations.
Hi, I'm Julie Reeves. You're watching Green at Beacon.com, a member of the Beacon Media Group.
The force, it's got a lot of power, and it makes me feel like that.
Welcome back to Midweek Sports Shop Talk. I'm Aaron Snyder with The Independent, and I'm here with Hank Bond of the Green at Beacon, and we'd like to invite you to come back next week, next Wednesday at 1 p.m. We're not sure of who the guest will be yet, but we'll bring in somebody, a special guest that we'll interview here, and just like we did with East Carter girls basketball coach Hager Easterling today. And we want to thank him for being on the show, and we want to thank Steve and Dee Dee Barfield of Chick-fil-A again for letting us have this space every week, and we want to thank our sponsor, First and People's Bank. Have a great day. Get back to work or whatever you're doing. This is Midweek Sports Shop Talk.
Hi, I'm Julie Reeves. You're watching Green at Beacon.com, a member of the Beacon Media Group.